Thank you for having me here today. I appreciate the opportunity, and thank you to our students, because I think you articulated beautifully some advice to us, so I appreciate your input. I have a presentation I was going to work through, and I think I'll just do selective parts of it based on Dr. Cook's remarks, and I wish he was still here. I think I'd like to change the conversation a little bit. If we reflect on what he said, I think it was a fantastic analysis of an old industry. And if that was truly the future of where McGraw-Hill thought higher ed needed to go, his advice would be very salient. But I'm concerned that it sends this conference into a direction that could potentially not be as fruitful. So let me provide an alternate vision, if that's okay. And it's really about this slide, and he had a similar one with one line missing. And it was the line that represents the total cost of higher education. And it is true, textbook prices have gone up and costs have gone up, and you can't refute that. And it is true, I don't see many students who are clamoring for an ebook. I'm not, are you? And it is true that the world has changed. My 11-year-old son learns more about computer programming from Paul Soure's tutorials on Minecraft on YouTube than any textbook he'll ever get. And I think that's cool. The truth is, the costs are going up, but there's a bigger crisis. And where you choose to spend your energies will depend on the impact that we create in these next 2 days, I believe. The truth is, and you all know this, completion rates aren't where they need to be. Those 10 students who start ninth grade, 3 of them are going to graduate. In a society that more than ever needs highly educated, creative, smart individuals like the students we just saw, we need you. And if you want to go into computer science, come find me. And the truth is, we have the gall to measure completion rates for a 4-year degree based on 6 years. This doesn't work. It's not sustainable. And a free textbook, an open source textbook, an ebook, driving textbook prices to zero is not the answer. And if McGraw-Hill could never publish another textbook, we'd be happy with that. Because we know there are better ways. We know it's about participant-centered learning. Put the student in the center. We know it's about, and I've been on campuses for a quarter of my career, hopefully being productive. I was fortunate to work with Clay Christensen. I think, without trying to put words in his mouth, because he's way smarter than I am, The Innovator's Dilemma isn't the right book to reference. It's Disrupting Class. And I encourage you, if you're going to read any of Clay's work, read Disrupting Class. Because it's really what this conversation is about. It's about the student has changed. It's about meeting them in a way that's engaging. It's about when we convene them in a room like this, it's about action learning. It's about student demonstrating mastery through their own work. It's about information literacy. It's about using everything that's open for good purpose to build skill. But of course, none of that happens without some basic scaffolding. And we hope that McGraw-Hill plays a small role in that as we transform from being a publisher and a textbook company, something we're actually quite proud of, because many of us in this room receive really high quality degrees because of that work. But it's something that we realize is a model that's changed. And so I know this conference is about sort of the future of the textbook, but is it really that, or is it about the future of how we're going to remain relevant in teaching and learning? And I, for one, decided to move out of a pure technology career where I could have been extremely financially successful. I was part of a group in the late 90s that built something called packet switching, or late 80s, sorry, that built something called packet switching that became the backbone of this thing called the internet. You've heard of it? I worked for both Brannick and Newman. I was part of a group that created this technology that created dynamic websites that we gave to this other community called Java. Probably heard of that too. And I found none of that fulfilling. And as the father of a university, or the son of a university president, and as the son of a K-12 teacher, as the father of 2 dyslexic children, as a person who's massively dyslexic himself, I've decided to put my energy back into teaching and learning. And so I think today, it's a question this conference can grapple with. If you want to drive down the cost of the textbook, if you want to focus on the future of the textbook, go for it. But are you relevant? So what McGraw-Hill has done is over the past few years, and the data you saw was actually when we were part of the McGraw-Hill companies, which is a very different organization than we are as an independent learning company today. Small correction, we're actually not publicly owned, we're privately owned. Some of that data was out of date, it's another issue. What McGraw-Hill is doing, and David Levitt actually was just interviewed, our CEO was interviewed today, and I think he said it beautifully. What we want to do is work with you in partnership to do the right things that help our students. And what we believe that's based on is data-driven learning in the learning moment. We don't believe in big data. We don't believe in give us every click the student ever uses and give us all this demographic and let's try and see what we can infer. We believe in this. We believe in every domain there's a learning map. There's a set of objectives and competencies that we need to impart into our young people to build the scaffolding so they have a proficient understanding from which they can grow, imagine, explore, and change the world. We believe that some of that scaffolding can be enabled with the help of technology in service of a master teacher and a student. Unlike others, and I am not a futurist, so I have no predictions. If I did, I'd go do something else. We believe that that student-teacher relationship is paramount. The only reason I'm in technology is because of Professor Lacase in Brunswick, Maine in 1982. And he told me I had an aptitude for it. I didn't even see it. We believe that the more we can enable that relationship, the more we help. We believe the way we do that is by taking that scaffolding and using technology in purposeful and good ways. So if there are fundamental learning objectives that the student can practice in a safe, engaging, and sometimes competitive fashion, almost game-like, let's work with you to offer that. We believe the syllabi is yours. Now, as Stephen Laster, not McGraw-Hill, as having been on campus many times, we wonder how many variants of syllabi are necessary for the same course. We know academic freedom is important. Don't want to take away from that. But on the other hand, if we want to create some efficiencies in education, where are there opportunities to standardize? Where are the opportunities to take our hard work and get it through a large number of students? Because the truth is, everything we do has a cost. A cost of time, a cost of money, a cost of lost focus on other opportunities. And as we take what's best in the United States, one of the things I would argue is our educational system, we have choices to make. And so where we see McGraw-Hill helping and other learning companies helping is by being a convener and collector of ideas, by ensuring that there's rigor behind them, by delivering and creating technologies that drive engagement, and by then turning the learning experience back to the people who can most use it and most benefit from it, educators and students. And so for us, I'm not sure it's a question about the future of the textbook as much as it is the future of the learning experience. And I can assure you, there's never going to be an ebook created that on its own will be engaging as a learning environment that has some competition in it, that will be engaging in a learning environment that brings learners together, whether shoulder to shoulder or through technology-assisted community. And what I can also tell you, because we see this frequently today, is that when we can instrument that learning environment in ways that are useful to student and teacher, learning happens faster. Outcomes go up. We believe college is worth it, by the way, and the data shows us that. So on the one hand, we have completion rates, and on the other hand, we have high costs going up. Costs going up in ways that are unsustainable. There are some that would say the 4,500 institutions that we have in the States today are not sustainable. I don't know. But what we do know is that as a society, if we view income as a measure of success, and it's not the only measure, I think I'm a liberal arts graduate and proud of it. I certainly graduated college with no idea that I'd be chief digital officer one day, and that's pretty cool. I actually started my career running a boatyard. It's been a long journey. We believe it's worth it. And so we look at a very simple equation. We see the problem, yes, affordability, but also completion. Because what the data also shows us is that if we can get the student to completion, they're actually productively able to pay off their education. Does that mean education should be less expensive? Sure, everything should be, as long as quality is maintained. And that should be a drive we all commit towards every day. What's the biggest cost in education, anybody know? It's the biggest driver of cost in higher ed today. Human time, salary and benefits. So how we spend the next hour matters. By the way, it's the same driver of cost to, I think Dr. Cook called them publishers. Same driver. This is about smart humans working together to make our next generation better off. So we have to look at affordability in the whole picture. And then we have to look at the structural impediments to completion. I spend a lot of time on campuses now so that I'm not sitting in an ivory tower. And I know that most of our students are working 2 to 3 jobs and then trying to study. I know that that last $100 of cost can make a tremendous difference in terms of being able to register for a course or not. And I know we have policies and procedures that get in the way of completion as much as cost does. What if we looked at it systemically? What if we put the student at the center versus sitting and saying who's good and who's not? And what if we took our collective capability and did in fact lower costs at the same time we drove student success up? So we asked ourselves that question starting about 3 or 4 years ago, how could we help? Because we believe we're a participant in a learning ecosystem. We're not the sole answer, and we're not the sole problem, but where we engage, we want to do our best. And so for us, it really was about personalized learning. Not that it's machine and student, because we hold the faculty at the center. That ability to mentor, to guide, to inspire is paramount. After all, we're still humans, thank goodness. I don't see that changing in my prediction. But we also know that based on cognitive science, and maybe a bad analogy, similar to learning golf, by the way, I don't play. I'm a fisherman, very different. But I've been told that you get really good in golf when you build automaticity and muscle memory. I do know from being dyslexic and having 2 highly dyslexic children who are fortunate enough to go to a school that teaches to their learning style, that the same is true in the mind. And that through neuroplasticity and through direct pedagogy and teaching methods, you build automaticity. If we look at K-12, this really matters for numeracy and literacy. And if you come unprepared to college and you really don't have literacy or numeracy, nothing else matters. Question, where should we start? So taking this knowledge and working with experts, we were able to then build learning experiences that are data-driven. They're called quote-unquote adaptive. That's a broadly used word that means different things to different people. What we're saying is that we're looking at small learning interaction data. We're looking at learner confidence. We're looking at their engagement. And then we're looking at, of course, at their answers to assessments and probes. And through that work, coupled with neuroscience, we're able to prevent them from getting lost in the next step of a knowledge map. We're also able to encourage them to go on. This works really well when you're scaffolding initially into a discipline or topic. If we can make this happen so then excitement and engagement is preserved, they're then the teachers to take to bigger and broader areas. Conversely, without the core understanding of any topic or discipline, it's hard to do higher order level learning. And that's where we think we help. And so we've seen it in places like University of Cincinnati, where we've run experiments, and we've seen pass rates go up. There's no magic here. It's about meeting the student where they can learn in partnership. We've seen it in pre-calculus courses, and we've seen it in business courses, and I could continue to cite examples, but I won't. I don't want to use my time up or abuse my time. My message is this. We're at a moment in time where we can decide. If you would like to have a conversation about the price of textbooks, let's have it. They're too expensive. When would you like to stop using them? Tell us and we'll stop. But don't look to inferior goods to solve the higher ed crisis. This is really about cost-effective completion rates. And if you'd like to have that conversation, we'd like to be your partner and innovate and experiment and put our children at the center. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. I want to say that I appreciate your challenge to us. One of the things regarding, I think, the concept of textbooks and all of the things that we're doing, these are all very complex issues. And we could probably have years of discussion, particularly when we're talking about professors involved, about all of these things. So we have to focus. And so this is a tool that has been a tool that we have used in our classrooms for years and years and years. And it is a time of change, so it presents an opportunity for us to have those questions. And so I appreciate your challenges back to us from Dr. Cook's comments. At this point, I'd like to introduce to you David Harris, who is the editor-in-chief of OpenStax at Rice University. And you know how we are in the South, we like accents. We appreciate accents a lot. And David has a little bit of a different kind of accent. But he has worked in publishing for many years, and he was the president of WebAssign. We've had an opportunity to work with David on some of our projects in the Affordable Learning Georgia, and we really have appreciated not only David, but his team in terms of working with us on those efforts. And so with that, David.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd really like to thank you for having me speak with you today. I would say, Stephen, working with Affordable Learning Georgia, working with UGA, with Lauren and Eddie Watson, they understand that this is a lot more than just about a textbook. They are working with faculty to develop affordable resources of the highest quality that include interactive elements, that include diagnostic testing. So I would argue there is a very sophisticated understanding of what the textbook is and what it isn't. All right, so we're based out of Rice University. We're a nonprofit organization. And what I thought I'd do today is just give you an overview of what OpenStax College is, in case you haven't heard about it. And then I want to talk a little bit about content, and is it alive and well, and what is the future of the textbook. And then I want to spend a little bit of time on a new distributed model. Dr. Clark talked about a sustainability model. Critically important, especially as we move to more affordable solutions. And then I'll focus on, if we have time, a little bit on no OER questions. I would say this is a time of great opportunity for all of us. There have never been so many new pedagogies, new technologies that we can deploy to improve learning. But let's start with OpenStax College. OpenStax College was really done to address some of the limitations of what we call OER 1.0. This might be the only slide that we agree upon. The problem with OER 1.0 is that there was inconsistent quality standards. You didn't really know if the materials would meet the thresholds that you have in your course. There was a lack of coordination around a common core. There were too many disparate efforts. How can we concentrate our resources to really amplify the quality? We made it very difficult to find turnkey solutions for faculty. They had to source from multiple areas and try and piece this together. There were very few OER blended solutions, and this gets into that textbook discussion. OER was either just a text or it was a widget. And we know that in today's classroom, we use a blended environment of both traditional text resources and also online interactive resources. Faculty tend to adapt after they adopt. They're not going to go and do a lot of building. They don't have the time for it. There was a lack of cooperation with for-profit providers. It was the OER world, and then, oh, we can't partner with the for-profits. We think the for-profits play a very important role, will continue to play a role, and we want to partner with them. And we'll discuss that a little bit later. And there needs to be a sustainable reward structure for content producers. Authors need to be paid. This cannot be a volunteer model. And then finally, most importantly, learning must be the priority and not free. And so OER 2.0 addresses this. And we were generously funded by the Gates Foundation, the Hewlett Foundation, the Arnold Foundation, to really develop a library of 25 very high quality OER textbooks. These are freely licensed, openly licensed with the CC BY license. They are free for students to download. But most importantly, they are professionally developed by the same group that also develops books for the major publishers. They meet the scope and sequence requirements of typical courses. And they're also supported by technology. We now have 9 titles published, and there will be 25 by the time the library is complete. So what are the results? How is the community responding? Superbly. Today, we have over 1,100 adoptions. This is a little bit out of date by a couple of days. In over 875 institutions, we served 173,000 students this fall. The cumulative students to date is 307,000. And this is giving these students access the first day of class. And the savings to date, over $30 million. And this is just the beginning. And this savings number, by the way, is based on a discounted price to factor in used books, rentals, etc. So what is the future of the textbook? Is it dead on arrival? Well, Brian Kibbe said, I think it's the former president of McGraw-Hill, textbooks are dead. They're dinosaurs. Well, we'd say we respectfully disagree. Students learn differently. Some students want a printed text. Other students want to download a PDF and print out pages as they go. Others want it on their iPad. It doesn't matter. We shouldn't be picking winners and losers in that. We need to provide access at multiple points. It's that simple. We believe that technology can enable content and learning. Fundamentally believe this. But high quality content is still required. We are working on adaptive learning programs that will also be openly licensed with machine learning and cognitive science principles. And these books eventually will be able to adapt to the student. But it will still require subject matter expertise of authors and professional development. But we'll be able to use data in the future, how the student interacts with the resources, how much time they spend on a question, to be able to guide the future development of these open resources. So the future of the textbook is very, very bright. I think a critical component of the future of the textbook gets around digital rights management. As I said, all of the OpenStax college materials carry a CC BY license. It means they have a copyright, but it means that you have an unrestricted terms of use. So if you're a student, what does that mean? That means you have unlimited access. Access never expires. I don't understand this. When I buy a trade book for my iPad, I own it forever. My daughter goes and downloads an ebook from a major publisher for one of her college courses. It expires after 180 days. I don't know how that supports an academic endeavor. I don't think it does. Unlimited printing. You can print out as many pages as you want. And you know what we're finding out? What students do is it's fine to give them, you can print out up to 150% of the pages. But what students actually do is they go and reprint the same section over and over again. So remove those barriers. Let students print as they need. And they want multiple access points across multiple devices. They want it on their smartphone, they want it on their iPad, they want it on their desktop. Anywhere, anytime, any format, that's what they want. And I think the last point here is probably the most important, is students, well, we all increasingly are, we live in online environments. Students are forming informal online social networks, and they need to be able to share this information. That's where students live today and in the future. And this is critically important for the publishers. I would encourage them to really think about loosening their DRM strategies. Otherwise, they are going to lose a generation of students. Also, in regards to the future of the textbook, is enhancing academic freedom. This is absolutely core to what we do at OpenStax, and obviously what we believe, since we're based out of Rice University. Open education resources improve choice for you. You have more options than ever before. It would be great if sometime in the future you'd be able to take proprietary content with open content and mix it together to get you exactly what you need. It frees up the ability to use multiple or different platforms. You don't have to be locked into a single author and a single platform. More choice for you. And if you need to adapt it to make it locally contextualized, you can do that without having to ask for permission. It puts it all back on you, and that's where it needs to be. So, the future of the textbook, reducing friction costs. We're talking about making this more affordable, and not just the textbook, but the interactive experience. And these are some of the challenges. They were identified earlier. Going digital is expensive. I took this from EduCourse. I took a picture of this. This is Cengage. No less than 13 platforms they're supporting here. Can you imagine the cost of that? That means you've got to train multiple sales forces, multiple technical support. You've got to update it all the time. At scale, that becomes prohibitively expensive. You can begin to understand why the prices might be so expensive. Legacy production processes for publishers. You have to put it in multiple different formats. If you do it in InDesign, then you've got to make a change for the Kindle. It gets very expensive, especially when you're doing so many revisions. $200 free comps. This is enormously expensive. The publisher sends out the comps, sometimes blindly. They go to the professor, and then some of those enter a used book market. And here I really have compassion for the publisher. So the comp costs them $50 to get into the professor's hands. And then if it gets into the used book market, they lose the revenue on that comp. That costs them $200. Multiply this all over the country, and you're looking at enormous costs. We have to get these costs out of there. And then finally, returns, all the books that go back and forth between the bookstores. So I think that openly licensed materials can reduce friction costs and make things a lot more affordable while retaining quality, which is critically important. So let's talk about the future and the textbook. What we're talking about, as we all know, is the dissemination and the use of content to drive learning. We used to be in what we called a text-centered environment. That was many years ago. But today, what we're in is something I think much more interesting, a lot more dynamic. High-quality, user-focused content. That means adaptive online homework systems that are going to be driven by data. It's going to learn about the student and then provide them with a pathway to help them improve their return on effort. Community-based content. Schools are trying to wrestle with, how do we reconcile with MOOCs? Locally contextualized content, community-based content, infusing that in. And then exam prep. You know, this generation of students come from No Child Left Behind. And historically it was, professor, what's on the exam? Now it is, well, how are you going to help me prep for the exam? We need to provide these resources for students because that's the way that they're coming through the system. This is going to have a transformative effect, it is, on the industry. And open resources provide you with that flexibility to use these to maximum availability. There is an ecosystem building up around OER, and this really gets into that sustainability question. Because you want to make sure that the resources that you use are going to be around for a long time. But let me dispel one myth. If it carries a CC BY license, it is around forever. Once you download it, you own it forever. The community owns it. So even if the entity that produces it goes away, it's still in the community. But OER needs a system, a sustainability system. And what we're seeing emerging is this ecosystem, where you have OER producers, the academic community, like this partnership we have in Georgia, where we work together to solve these issues and problems, with publishers too, and with the legislative community to come up with a system that's much more efficient. And this we are now seeing, this is no longer just a theoretical model, we're seeing this in action, and it's very, very exciting. At OpenStax College, we now have 22 ecosystem partners, and I put them into some buckets here, and these are just representatives of them. So for students with Apple, you can download a high fidelity version on iPad. We distribute through Amazon. For faculty, we have partnerships, because it's not much more than just about the textbook. We have partnerships with WebAssign, Sapling Learning, with John Wiley and Sons. And they are providing services around this open content. And the beauty of it is that they offer these services at a fraction of the cost. No, it's not free, but remember, these are called open education resources, not free education resources. And what they do, these organizations that have partnered with us, they provide a mission support fee back to OpenStax. In fact, this has become so successful that we are actually publishing a revision based on these funds in sociology next year. And at scale, and we're rapidly approaching scale, this will be sustainable. Caveat, we are a nonprofit. It's not a for-profit model. Okay, so there's role for everyone. So the future of the textbook considerations. How do we support academic research in terms of these new technologies, these adaptive programs, to shift away from hype to efficacy? Fundamentally important question. How effective is OER in the classroom? Kim Davenport will actually have a session tomorrow at 10 where she's going to be exploring these questions of research. It's critically important. What are the strategies to enhance collaboration between nonprofits, for-profits, and public organizations? Like the partnership we have with the University System of Georgia. How can we expand these so we can all work together to improve quality and drive down costs? The third question is a fundamental one. How do we protect students' privacy as we're moving into this data era and manage data at the same time? What do I mean by that? Well, FERPA takes care of the student privacy piece, but a lot of anonymized data is being collected. So I think the question for the institution is, do we want our vendors to know more about our students than we do? Or do we demand open data that we can share with other institutions so that collectively as a community we can improve learning? It's a fundamental question. I don't have the answer to it, but it's one that needs to be wrestled with. And then how do we continue to enhance academic freedom? That is the vibrancy of the academy, number one. Number two, it is the quality control gate. I think this is what academic freedom has actually driven the success of OpenStax College. Institutional drivers in the future. Well, we talked about the University System of Georgia. This is something that we are seeing all over the country, and it's really started to appear in the last year. It is incredible how institutions are getting involved with their centers of teaching of excellence, with faculty, to take open resources and new digital technologies to really advance the state of learning. So I'm going to close quickly with what I would call no and OER questions. These are normally the questions we get regarding open education resources. I didn't have our number one question, because our books are free, they're openly licensed, anyone's free to use them. The number one question is, David, what's the catch or obligation? Guess what? There isn't, none. There is no obligation. We only ask, if you like them, let someone know. What do I tell the provost who's worried about lost bookstore revenue? That came up today. Well, the truth of the matter is that our materials are available in print, and the bookstore can buy them. And what we have seen is that sell-through rates, because the price is so affordable, our Introduction to Sociology book is $28.75, is 100%. And so they actually do okay. Also, we have to recognize, I think it was made earlier very well, is that students are going elsewhere online to get resources. So if I'm a bookstore, if I can work with faculty to create a custom version locally, that might be a way to use OER. The publishers are lowering prices. Doesn't this eliminate the need for OER? We saw that today. Well, we would say if students can have unfettered access, multiple points, access doesn't expire, and then they can share it on their online networks, and the prices go down, that is terrific. That is a huge development forward, and we support it. Our mission is done. Great. Good news. Why is OER free like a puppy? Because like anything else, you're going to have to invest in it. Like when you make a transition from one text to another, it takes time. And this is no different. There's no magic pill here. This takes effort. The publishers are providing all types of technology. How does OER respond? How can that be free? Well, it's not free. And we have partnerships with leading technology providers. And so that resource is available to you. And you will see OER groups developing more and more enabling technology and embedding enabling technology within the content. And what is the most common objection you hear from faculty? Now, I've thought long and hard on that. Probably the most common objection is very typical. You know, I don't like the way you cover X or Y. I think the author's perspective is incorrect. And that's right, these books are not perfect. But the beauty of them is you can edit them and then make them your own, make them more practical for your classroom. And so when it comes to no is our favorite word because it makes yes so much more enjoyable. So, I got just one more here. So we think the future is very bright. We think there's a role for everyone. And the discussion today, and we're going to have over the next couple days, is very empowering. Because at the end of the day, it's about the student and improving learning and improving access. And together, we can do this. And we're going to build the most sustainable future ever. And I'm inspired every day by Gandhi's quote, first they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, and then we all win. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, David, for that perspective. We have some time for questions. We'll get you next when she brings the mic.
Hi, asking a question out of ignorance, really. Most of, I would imagine, I don't even know who this is directed to, but Dave and I were talking, I didn't have a textbook after my freshman year of college. I studied humanities, mm-hmm. Right? And I was thinking about big publishers, non-textbooks. And one concern people have is that as their profit margins go down, their ability to finance books that are needed but not make money goes down as much. And I'd like, to hear how you respond to those courses in upper division, graduate school courses that need textbooks, but essentially have never been profitable. Mm-hmm. But where do they find a home?
Go ahead. It's interesting. So before the consolidation of the publishing industry, the publishers were very vertical on their lists. And they did exactly what you said. The intro courses supported the development of the upper level titles. In fact, it was a sales strategy. If we show that we're supporting the upper level curriculum, they might adopt my introductory title. Since the consolidation, the publishers are a lot flatter. They're much less vertical. This has always been good for the publisher because in those lower level markets, you have peak years and valley years. Some publishers are still much more vertical. John Wiley & Sons is a very vertical publisher. But I agree, I do think that this is a concern. The university presses might do well to look at this as a market opportunity because I think they are really challenged in the scholarly area. I think eventually that is going to become a need. I agree with you 100%.
Yeah, I would just add that I think the answer to it is us all becoming more efficient and finding the inefficiencies and getting and creating the knowledge and getting it out. It may be that some of these courses lend themselves perfectly to OER only. It may be some of them lend themselves because of their cost of physical that they're digital only. It may be, as my colleague said, that university presses or niche publishers actually find a really good market here. And the truth is it's going to be some of everything. You know, I think the way those courses continue to be well cared for is through active faculty participation in the solution. And into ensuring that we're only creating the instructional resources and text, be it a traditional book or a more of a textbook or some other ancillary or digital, is that we do this in the goal of imparting really effective teaching to the student. Because what we do know is that when we're offering things that students use, those sustain themselves through all these different models. And so if we keep that student in the center, I think it takes care of itself.
Thank you so much for presenting both sides of the educational resources. It was great. My question is, say 20, 30 years ago when I was, maybe I shouldn't give out my age, when we were studying, the textbook was the only source or maybe some reference material in the library that would give you the basic concepts. And, you know, most of us learned those, memorized those, or, you know, whatever, however we did it, we did it. But in today's world, that information is at your fingertips. Whether you pick up a cell phone or you pick up a, you know, a iPad or whatever. So coming from an educational perspective, what I feel is since the students already have these resources at their fingertips, should we move away from having this information in textbooks over and over rather than focus more on how to apply the information that is there in front of them at their fingertips? How can these students that are so technologically savvy use the information that is available at their fingertips and maybe solve a problem? Are they able to use this information? That's where I think. I mean, what do you have to say about it?
So I would agree with you. And I think you've seen McGraw-Hill put a lot of emphasis exactly in that direction through the technology-enabled adaptive learning environments that we offer. We do know, to your point, that trustable, curated knowledge objects remain centrally important because we also know that our students are not born with information literacy and they have a hard time discriminating against quality and accuracy of what's out there. And we need to teach them to do that better, for sure. It's a whole other conversation. But where you see us putting our energy is not to say we're the sole provider of truth, and you see us continuing to open up and to blend, and we do encourage for instructor and what would you call local resources mm-hmm. blended into the offering. We think every faculty member should make the course their own for all the good reasons. But you see us putting significantly more energy into environments where either alone or in teams, they can practice with the information to turn it into mastery. Because it's one thing to go and find stuff. As we all know, it's another thing to be able to use it and then build upon it. And so you described it much better than I am right now, but it's exactly that area that we see the highest and best use of our time.
I agree with that 100%. I mean, that issue of having information at your fingertips, it's a double-edged sword, because it's not always vetted. And that's something that I think McGraw-Hill does a fantastic job of vetting that content, evaluating it, and that adds value to it. And that's not going to go away over time. Finding that author who knows how to explain it clearly and specifically, that's a lot of work. And you know, a Wikipedia article might be useful, but you don't. Can you trust it?
Other questions?
This is a question for Stephen. So my faculty and others in the United States and elsewhere are developing the textbooks. You're editing, there's peer review. Could you talk about how the adaptive learning solutions are developed and is there an equivalent of peer review and how does that all take place?
There is, and some of your faculty may be helping us for all I know, but it is an evolutionary model. So there's a couple of pieces to it. There's the underlying technology, which is not super interesting unless you're nerdy like me. There's the construction then of knowledge maps, and many of your faculty are helping us build the knowledge map, and there's peer review against those. And then those knowledge maps are built out both to learning statements and learning objectives. Those are peer reviewed. And then there's classroom trialing of the adaptive course, to use the metaphor we all know. And so all of that to bring sort of a course's worth of an adaptive experience to market, it's about a 2-year process because it goes through all the review and trialing. What we haven't found is a way just to sort of offer the technology here and say people can pour content in and ta-da, something good works. If it was that easy, honestly, we'd do it. But what we see is that, you know, all of the disciplines and the interdisciplinary work that we're engaged in teaching, there's competencies and abilities and scaffolding that's necessary to make sure somebody has appropriately acquired the capability. And so that's why we do the review and the trialing and the feedback loops. That's in development. In production, or when it's being used in teaching, something like LearnSmart allows the students to give the subject matter experts faculty feedback as well. So the relationship of faculty to us changes in this new world, meaning that if I were a faculty member working with McGraw-Hill responsible for an area of knowledge, once I think I've created it, my job's not done. Because as the students use it, we build mechanisms that go in an automated fashion back to the person who created it that said, you know, here's a whole population that says, we don't understand you. You think you're explaining this to us, but we don't get it. And so it's an evergreen revision process. So it's both of those steps.
One more quick question.
Sorry, so just to follow on to that question, you talked about the process of how the content is reviewed and the structure is reviewed and the maps are reviewed. The real differentiator between adaptive and flat is in the algorithms and in the way those decisions are made and what gets done based on the decision. Are the algorithms that are driving adaptation public and transparent and available for peer review?
So, for example, our Alex platform, you can go freely get the entire dissertation on how it works. So the answer is yes.